For the invitation, it's a privilege to be to participate in a conference that honors a great scientist, one that I greatly admire and respect. I understood the invitation to encourage us to be controversial. And I took that probably a bit too seriously, because when I looked at the list of abstracts, I realized maybe I should not have included so many questions that relate to the beginning and the end of the universe. So, let's start with stuff that we do know. Our universe started with cosmic inflation. In a fraction of a second, it blew up from a small size, and it continues to grow to present day. As the universe grows, the temperature cools down, and the primordial ripples in the inflaton particle induce ripples in the space-time metric, and eventually, those, whenever you have concentrations of those, they collapse under their own gravitational weight. And that's how we get structure. It's a perfect theory. It explains homogeneity, uniformity, and flatness in the universe. It agrees exquisitely well with our observations of the cosmic microwave background and the large-scale structure. And it also tells us that it took about 4.5 billion years for us to be here today. There's non-linear fluctuations. That was the problem. Well, the problem is what gave it. What gave the high energy of cosmic inflation, and was there anything before? Of course, one favorite answer so far has been a rephrasing of St. Augustine. There is hell for those that to pay for those that ask the question, what was there before? So we can think of one universe with nothing before. That's an answer, but it runs into problems. And I believe Sir Roger Penrose was the first one to assign a number to that problem. So if we use the famous Boltzmann entropy relation to the probability, then we can invert that relation and ask the question, what's the probability of starting with a universe at high energy inflation like ours? We know the entropy of our universe at present. We can run it backward in time to figure out what the entropy was at the first moment of creation. And by inverting that expression, we can calculate the probability for that initial moment to occur. And that's what Roger did, and he found out that our universe has one chance in 10^10^123 to start the way it did. This is, of course, this kind of number makes us nervous, and it makes the problem of the origin of the universe very serious. How can we live in a universe that had such an incredibly low entropy or such an exquisitely special initial state? Which is the reason why we haven't given up on asking the question, how did our universe start? What gave the energy, the high energy of cosmic inflation? And when you look at numbers like that, that make all physicists very nervous, that kind of answer is not very different from James Usher's calculation. He was a very erudite man, an archbishop, and studying various books, he figured out that our universe was created at exactly 6 p.m. on 22nd of October, 4004 BC. Now, of course, we laugh at it today. It was taken seriously for a few hundred years. And when you compare it to the number that I showed you before, the two are not really very different from each other as ethical problems. Okay, all of these troubles seem to come from the second law of thermodynamics. It's the most fundamental law, probably, in nature. It's an empirical law. It's one that doesn't come with a theory. But on the other hand, there is absolutely no indication that there are any problems or any violations of the second law of thermodynamics so far. As I showed you, the calculation that Roger did was based on using the fact that if entropy is a certain amount today, it must have been very small back then, and by inverting that entropy into a probability calculation. So, does that mean that problem is real? Does it mean that our universe did indeed start at an exquisitely, especially early interstate, initial state? Probably not, because if we have one universe and we compare the initial state with the present state or a future state of that universe, the second law of thermodynamics guarantees that the previous state will be of lower entropy. It doesn't have to be a universe that started at high energies with cosmic inflation. It can be any universe, one that started at low energies. It doesn't have to be a universe that expands like ours. It can be any universe, one that starts as big and full of structure and radiation and everything else we see in our universe today, and it decides to crunch in the future. And it can be a bouncing universe. It grows, it crunches, it grows back, it crunches again. Any kind of universe we can think of, by the second law of thermodynamics, it will always run into the problem of an exquisitely special initial state, because that initial state is being compared with a later state within the same universe, which is guaranteed by the second law of thermodynamics to be a higher entropy state. So perhaps that is the problem.
Could be the same.
Or the same. So certainly, yeah. I'll get to the cosmic heat then, for it remains the same. But the sitter.
The standard Boltzmann logic, most of them are the same.
Well, Boltzmann had his own troubles that you had into with Goschmidt, so we can talk about that later. But yes, entropy can remain the same. But you can't have a future state be of lower entropy than the initial state. And entropy remains the same only in extremely special cases, like the sitter universe. No. Okay. So perhaps we're asking the question the wrong way. I spent a lot of time thinking about this. This is one of the most attractive problems in cosmology. Why did our universe start the way it did? And I realized that the question of comparing entropies and converting them into probability statements is probably related to the fact that we need to compare different initial states, the entropies and the probabilities of different initial states of different universes, in other words, in order to make sense of that question. Why did ours start at a different entropy and a different probability from another initial state, rather than compare states within the same universe? In fact, I could not understand how we can even ask the question, why did we start with this universe, if there isn't a pool of possibilities, of choices, from which to choose our universe. And in that case, if we had that pool, then the question, what's the chance of starting with this one rather than something else, would make sense. Now, I promised you I was going to be controversial, so if you follow along those lines, that leads to a multiverse description of a universe like ours, that is a humble member in a much larger family, in a vast family of many possible universes. Of course, I've shown no calculation so far. There is a way to put some mathematical cash into this, and I'll talk about that in a minute. But even thinking about the question of the origin of the universe, it does seem to at least force us to keep an open mind on the possibility that there are many other universes, and we can compare ours only with others from that pool of universes. In which case, we're extending the Copernican principle to the largest possible scales, to the whole cosmos. But we're asking questions of the origin of the universe, and what was there before. And before implies time. So that's another trouble all theoretical physicists run into any time we sit down and think about the origin of the universe. Is there such a thing as before? Did time emerge with the universe? Or is it fundamental? It was always there. There is a minority of people that go as far as to say it's an illusion, the necessity that the human mind invented in order to describe the world around us. I'll stick with the first two, emergent or fundamental. That's a can of worms that We would probably need to spend the whole year in this room to even find the people that agree with each other on that. I ran that test. We organized once a conference with Brian Reed in New York exactly on this question. 1 week, people locked in the room and nobody would agree. So that's the kind of problem that probably will take much longer to understand and agree, have a consensus than the origin of the universe. Which leaves us in the position of having to pick one side. There are people that say time is emergent, it emerged with the universe itself, therefore there is nothing before. The before does not exist. So we are back to St. Augustine. And there are other people, especially the multiverse camp, that understand you need time to be fundamental, a very fundamental ingredient of the very fabric of the cosmos in order to have a description of events before our universe existed and beyond the horizon of our universe. I, you may have guessed, that subscribe to time being fundamental. Now, I promise that this is a very difficult problem, much more difficult than the origin problem. One is the nature of time, the one I mentioned, is time fundamental or emergent? But there is a whole family of problems. Another one is the era of time. Cosmic expansion gives an era of time. We can tell the difference between yesterday and tomorrow just by looking at the universe, at the size of the universe. Thermodynamics gives an era of time by the second law. Biology gives an era of time. We all age. So there are many eras of time. Our universe comes with one. And it all starts by the fact that our universe came into existence. So the era of time problem is closely related to the origin problem. If quantum theory is a fundamental description of nature, and we apply it at the moment of the origin of the universe, then an uncertainty built into our clocks that measure the passage of time can result in an uncertainty in the laws of nature. So even the era of time by itself can be a can of worms that relates to many problems that without which we cannot really understand the universe. And finally, there is the last equally difficult problem related to time is, I just mentioned that the universe comes with an era of time, cosmic expansion or thermodynamic. Yet, all the laws of nature we know in the form of theories, be it Maxwell's electromagnetism, Einstein's theory of relativity, or quantum theory, they can't tell the difference between yesterday and tomorrow. They have that symmetry built into them. Then how can we describe our universe? How can we trust them to describe a world which has violated that symmetry and comes with an era of time? Again, nobody knows. But I thought I'd just throw them there, and we can talk later after the talk, where you can ask me questions. So why are we suddenly about? These are problems that have been known for a long time in the past, that those were the types of problems that you spend time with in your spare time, and you never talk about and never publish. So how come suddenly these are the kind of problems that forefront research, and the kind that many researchers are putting a lot of time in understanding and working out? There are a few reasons. Of course, science is a pyramid. We have collected enough information where we have reached the stage that we are attacking the most important problems about the universe as a whole. And those two issues or discoveries that prompted us to tackle those problems, such as the origin of the universe, are first the discovery of dark energy, the same type of energy as that gave rise to the universe as cosmic inflation. That was discovered only in 1998, observationally, by the supernova team. So it's been only 20 years. We still don't understand what dark energy is, despite a few hundred or more papers and models in the market. But the fact that our universe is behaving in the same manner now as it did in the first moment of existence brings that problem back into focus. To make things worse, dark energy Not only is it there, but it also dominates the expansion of the universe. And since all the other matter, radiation, everything else, all the other ingredients that occupy the universe will gradually dilute as the universe grows, while dark energy has a peculiar feature. It has a nearly constant density. So as the volume of the universe grows, that energy grows with time. It also has the other peculiar property that makes it be this, of the same nature as the cosmic inflation. It has negative pressure. It blows things up. It doesn't crunch things. So not only will it dominate the universe within a short time, and I'm a cosmologist, so for me a short time means a few billion years, but not only will it dominate the universe, but it will determine how the universe will act. I thought we have no idea what it is. We can observe it by studying the large-scale structure or the motion of the stars, such as supernovae, but we have no good theoretical model for it yet. So there are three things dark energy can be. In fact, this year, the most recent data in the last few months, are making this field even more exciting. Let's stick with the three main contenders. Dark energy could be a pure energy of the vacuum, of the very fabric of space-time. A pure constant density, from now to forever. In that case, of course, it will dominate the universe pretty quickly. It will be 100% of the energy density in the universe. And, related to what Carlo asked before, that kind of scenario where you have a universe filled with pure vacuum energy gives you the cedar type universe, one that has to maintain the entropy a constant, just like the entropy of a black hole. So if entropy can't change, no heat exchange can occur, no work can be done, so no observers can be made. That universe is dead and empty forever and ever. Not to mention that the density of dark energy is very low. So this kind of heat bath, where the universe just is suspended in this state of Dante's Inferno forever, it maintains a constant entropy, a constant temperature everywhere, and it can never be populated by anything. So that kind of state for the universe is known as a cosmic heat death. Because the temperature of that cosmic heat bath is very low, sometimes this scenario is referred to as the big freeze. So, I don't know how to make this work, so I can't point to you, but the longest cone there is this cosmic heat death scenario for the universe. But dark energy could be a particle. It doesn't have to be a vacuum, pure vacuum energy. If it's a particle, it might decide to run really fast in the future. So it's fooling us now, temporarily, into thinking that it's a vacuum energy because it's maintaining its energy density to a constant, but it doesn't have to do that in the future. It can start moving very fast, running down a potential hill, in which case it will start behaving like a normal particle. One that has positive pressure, one that tends to crunch things, to pull things together. So in that case, the whole universe will be crunched into one point. That is a big crunch scenario. At least that's a quick death. The third one is the big leak. Again, in the theme of dark energy being a particle, but a very strange kind of particle. The kind of particle that has an energy that has even more negative pressures than pure vacuum energy. In which case, that acceleration, that push onto the universe will be even faster than that induced by vacuum energy. So you have the scenario where the energy dump in the universe, and this kind of particle is called phantom particle, the energy dump in the universe is such that the negative pressure, the push on the universe, it's increasing. And meanwhile, the energy density is increasing as well. So in that case, the universe, again, cannot survive that kind of push. It will be ripped apart. The very fabric of space-time is ripped apart. Even atoms will unbind. Of course, galaxies and stars and everything else, because they can't resist that kind of extremely accelerated expansion. So that's our problem, dark energy. We don't know what it is. But we need to know, because then we can predict how our universe will end. The second problem was this discovery of the lens beam of string theory around 2003-2004. Now, string theory is the leading candidate for our theory of quantum gravity, no question about it. And the hope, it has done extremely well in unifying gravitational forces to other forces, quantum forces. And the hope, of course, was that one day, after compacting time, the extra dimensions, we would end up with one four-dimensional world that looked exactly like our universe. Then we would have achieved our goal of having a theory that starts from 11 dimensions, or of now. But then, mathematically, you reduce it to one, and that is a four-dimensional world that looks like our universe. Our origin problem would have gone away there. The surprising in the early 2000s is that after a tremendous amount of mathematical efforts, we did find, or rather string theorists found, for a four-dimensional world, but they found billions and zillions and googolplexes of those. So rather than one four-dimensional universe, there was, for all practical purposes, an infinite amount of them. So suddenly, string theory was starting to look from a unified theory of a single universe to that of a multiverse. And that was a crisis. And there was good reason for that. Part of the dislike with the multiverse possibility is the fact that you are limited by the speed of light to be able to observe what lies beyond the horizon of our universe. In other words, we can't observe the multiverse. And if a theory cannot be tested, then it is not scientific. That's a good enough reason to really be scared if a theory like string theory suddenly ends up giving a landscape of possibilities. So one of the major efforts at the time was to try and appeal to the anthropic principle. It's pretty much a rephrasing of Descartes' "I think, therefore the universe exists." So the anthropic principle will advocate that we need observers, we need witnesses to observe the universe. So the only good universe in this vastness of the landscape or any other structure is the one that allows for structures like stars and galaxies to arise in them. Remember, I told you it takes 4.5 billion years to make us. And at the beginning of the universe, all we have is hydrogen. So we need the star factories to make the heavier elements and eventually produce us. So that's the anthropic principle, and that looked a very promising direction. Steven Weinberg, in fact, had predicted the amount of dark energy based on anthropic arguments. He had calculated that we need a certain amount, 10^-124 at the moment, of this dark energy ingredient, in order for the universe to be around long enough so that stars form and they are around sufficiently long for producing all the other heavier elements. So, anthropic principle was a possibility, and having predicted powers is a good thing. And with a few collaborators, we were interested in discovering the merit of the anthropic selection in a structure such as the landscape, but it can be any kind of multiverse structure. Fred Adams in Ann Arbor and I had initially looked at the Weinberg argument for a pure vacuum energy. As I told you when I talked about dark energy, a universe filled with pure vacuum energy will end up in a de Sitter state. It will have constant entropy, was the cosmic heat death scenario. It will have a constant temperature and entropy forever and ever. In other words, if you are really after observers, a universe with a constant vacuum energy in it should be your last choice. It's the worst universe to have. And that, of course, is if you put your observers in a four-dimensional volume. So you ask the question, if I were to drop in randomly at any time in a universe that has vacuum energy, what would I find there? The chances are that in the vast majority of the times of dropping, you find it there with no observers in it. So a universe with vacuum energy is a bad universe to try and appeal to the anthropic principle. However, that's not enough. Maybe dark energy is something else, which is not the vacuum energy. So Fred Evans and I, with Stefan Alexander and Ivan Gross, went further. We decided, okay, suppose we let Newton's constant float. Suppose we let fine structure constant float. Suppose we let baryon to photon ratio float. The amplitude of density fluctuations, those ripples that produce the structure in the universe, let that float. Allow these major cosmological parameters and constants of nature, which are responsible for producing observers, for producing those stars and galaxies, and therefore life, let them float and see if we can find any other universe that is habitable. If we couldn't, then of course the anthropic principle would have merit, because it would narrow down its prediction to within, very close to the number we observe in our universe, and we would have convinced ourselves that everything in our universe is fine-tuned, all the constants of nature are fine-tuned for exactly that purpose, to allow observers. We found out that's not the case. There is a vast, vast majority of habitable universes one can have when fine structure constant is 10,000 times less than the one we observe in our universe, when Newton's constant changes by six orders of magnitude. So the argument, that was the scariest part, that the arguments we used to calculate these plots, this parameter space where the constants of nature are allowed to flow, are actually very simple ones. We asked that our universe lived long enough so there's enough time for structure to form, and the stars live long enough so the weak interaction that will determine the neutron to proton ratio should not be frozen too soon or too late, because you want all the other processes like nuclear and gravitational forces inside the star to hold that star together. We asked for a minimal amount of complexity, 10 to the power 15 molecules minimum in the universe, so that life can eventually arise. And most importantly, water. We need water, which means hydrogen. You know from Big Bang nucleosynthesis that hydrogen is converted to deuterium, helium 3, and helium 4. We were interested in the universes that did not have a 100% efficient conversion. In other words, the kind that you still had the helium and the deuterium, but there was still some hydrogen left in order to have water later. So these were the constraints, very, very basic constraints, but still they told us a lot. So in that first plot there, we used the BBN code called BURST to run these constraints while allowing the parameters to flow. So in that first plot, you can see the baryon to photon ratio, eta, which in our universe is 10 to the minus 9. That's the vertical black line in the plot. And vertically, you have the mass fractions of these light elements that I mentioned, hydrogen, deuterium, helium 3, and helium 4. And the point is that you want enough hydrogen left, and that is the top blue line in that plot. So there's always some hydrogen left, no matter what. That conversion to other elements, although you can see that the baryon to photon ratio is changing by many orders of magnitude from our value, which is 10 to the minus 9. So you can have a universe where the baryon to photon ratio is 10 to the minus 12 or 10 to the minus 6. And you'll still have some hydrogen left over. So there will be water. Structure, allowing the gravitational constant, Newton's constant, G. It's normalized by G naught, which is the value of the Newton's constant in our universe. So again, the vertical black 9 is G equals G naught. It's our universe, the value of the Newton's constant in our universe. And you can see that we can vary either way, make it weaker, make gravity weaker, or make it stronger. And you still get all these elements, hydrogen left over, and helium, and deuterium, and everything else. So there's a lot of universes there that can have water, although they could have the gravitational constant be 10,000 times bigger than the one in our universe. Then there is the question of neutron to protons, left over, controlled by weak interaction. And inside the stars, of course, I mean, many of the neutrons and protons will end up making the star. And in there, you have the electromagnetic and the gravitational forces acting on the star. So we require that these weak interactions freeze out at the right time, not too quickly and not too late. If it's too quickly, then there will be no protons left around. If it's too late, then it's too many of them. And that was plotted in these contours is Newton's constant versus the baryon to photon ratio. Remember, in our universe, eta, the baryon to photon, is 10 to the minus 9, and that little red star there indicates the value for both Newton's constant and eta in our universe. But there is a whole wide range of parameters where G and eta can float, and you still have a perfectly good universe. And that's the weak interaction constraint that I mentioned, neutron to proton ratio in our universe, but I'll see that. Okay, so these were the very crude computation constraints that we introduced by allowing all these constants of nature to float. And eventually you are asking, since I mentioned we also allow the density fluctuation amplitude to not necessarily be 10 to the minus 5, like the one in our universe, to float, to be something different, even 10 to the minus 2, or 10 to the minus 10. So the only constraint in that case that we introduced was from structure formation. You want vacuum energy to dominate last. If you have too much dark energy at the beginning of the universe, you are going to blow it up non-structural form. So you want that to be last after everything else is created. That's the key number at the time at which vacuum energy dominates. The universe goes through the period of matter and radiation equality. You want that time of equality, of matter radiation equality, to occur after BBN has taken place. Again, these are very reasonable and very simple constraints, but all these time scales, whether it's BBN equality, matter radiation equality, or vacuum energy domination, all of those translate very, very simply, very straightforwardly into the next expression. How does that happen? Well, the energy density of matter equals the energy density of radiation. You know that radiation goes as temperature to the fourth, matter goes with Q. So you just make those equalities and you translate time scales into other cosmological parameters. And that surprised us for two reasons. First, that expression should seem theory. Q is the amplitude of density perturbations. That we allow that to float. So Q can be anything. It doesn't have to be the one in our universe. Eta was the baryon to photon ratio. Again, that's allowed to float. It can be anything. Rho lambda is the energy density of vacuum energy, of dark energy. Omega matter and omega b, omega m and b are total matter, including dark matter, and b is the baryonic energy density. So the first surprise was that the vacuum energy density in our universe seems to be constrained by these other constants of nature. For any universe you can think of, remember Q, lambda, G are floating. So for any universe you can think of, as long as the amount of vacuum energy you put in there satisfies that constraint, that bound, that's a perfectly good and habitable universe. Now, I showed you the parameter plot on how much those constants of nature can flow. If you put them in that expression, it turns out that the energy density for dark energy should always be less than about 10 to minus 90 relative to the planet mass 4. In other words, it can be a lot bigger than what it is in our universe by 30 orders of magnitude. So right there, the anthropic principle has lost its explanation power, because here is a simple relation that says vacuum energy doesn't have to be 10 to the minus 124, it can be 10 to the minus 90, if those other constants of nature are allowed to flow. So that was one important finding. The other one that intrigued us, and I still don't know the answer to that, is that there seems to be a microphysical connection between these constants of nature. In fact, let me rewrite the fine structure constant in there. It was hidden in the MPs and the omegas before. So I'm just rewriting that bound on rho lambda. I have defined alpha g to be the rescale of Newton's constant, g times problem mass square divided by h bar c, just to make it dimensionless. And alpha is the fine structure constant. So somehow the energy density of dark energy seems to be bound by Newton's constant and fine structure constant. A of r is just a number, it's pi squared divided by 3. And that I don't understand. Why should Newton's constant be related to fine structure constant and together put a bound on dark energy? But to me that's intriguing. Fred had previously found, before we did this work, that using similar constraints from your scale structure, that Newton's constant and fine structure constant have to obey a hierarchy. You can let them float by many orders of magnitude, but they need to obey that hierarchy where the ratio of the two is less than 34 orders of magnitude. So just with that constraint, you can allow Newton's constant and fine structure constant to completely float, and that expression, the second one there, will tell you on what the allowed vacuum energy of that particular universe is in order for the universe to be habitable. I am very intrigued, and that's the hierarchy of forces I mentioned. I'm very intrigued by this relation, and I really have no clue, no idea why fine structures constant should be related to vacuum energy and the gravitational constant. The only possibility that crosses my mind is that there is some topological factor happening there. Okay, so what gave the energy of inflation? What was there before? And how will the universe end? We still don't know the answer to these questions. Still, the two main trends are one universe, one unified theory, a multiverse, and our universe being one of many in there. In which case, at least, our origins are not special. The anthropic principle, I've tried to make a case, doesn't help very much in narrowing down the possibilities. String theory opened up those possibilities rather than narrowing them down. And the second law of thermodynamics, the way we apply to view the single universe, does not seem the right way to go about it. So when we compare entropy states, as fundamental as that is, we need to compare completely independent entropy states, not the ones within the same universe. So now I'll tell you my favorite answer. When the landscape discovery came about in 2004, I had been thinking about the problem of the origin, so I proposed immediately that there is a way we can calculate the answer other than apply the anthropic principle to narrow down the landscape. Just allow the wave function of the universe to go through the landscape of string theory. At least we have equations there, we can calculate what the solutions are to this wave function, square them, and I know I'm opening a can of worms here on the interpretation of probability, but whichever your favorite probability is, once you have the wave solution, you can get the probability for that particular branch to come into existence. Now, technically, of course, it's horrendous. The landscape, as I mentioned, is 10 to the power 600 vacuoles, and you can think of that as a potential energy field. So you are solving for the wave function of the universe to go through a nearly infinite string of many potential energies, of many vacuoles. But conceptually, it's very straightforward. I mean, if I have one potential well, that's what I will do. I will solve the Schrodinger type equation for the particle that's oscillating around that wave. So why can't I do the same for the landscape? That's what I did initially, and I got absolutely the wrong answer. And worse than that, it made me feel very stupid, because the answer I got was that the most probable solution to this wave function of the universe in the landscape is the one that sits at very low energies. Surprise. Of course, it's the one that sits at the lowest energies. So then I realized, it took me a few months, and Rich Holman joined me in that work. We realized that we're missing something very crucial. Decoherence. I mean, you are solving the Wheeler-DeWitt equation, which is the analog to a Schrodinger-type equation, so you get a family of solutions of branches for the wave function of the universe. Different branches will sit at different vacua on the landscape, so they will take different energies from which they can start their own defects and produce their own universes. But this is quantum, so all of these branches are entangled with one another. Somehow, to go from that quantum description of the universe as a wave to a classical description, a big expanding universe, that process, quantum to classical transition, has to be triggered by decoherence. The separation of all these branches from each other, the decoupling, the disentanglement of all the branches from each other, also needs decoherence. I know today that when I look at the sky out there, I don't see a million different skies blended into one, entangled into one. So I know for certain that our sky, our branch, decohered early on from everything else. So with Rich, we included a bug, an environment, the typical way to induce decoherence. And those were the very long wavelength fluctuations that are present in the wave function and the landscape. Long wavelength because we want their coupling to our system for the branch to be very weak, and it's gravitational. So long wavelength means very weakly coupled. Otherwise, they, in the process of measuring the system, they would interfere with the process of measurement. There's still an infinite number of those long wavelength modes. So we went back to solving the equation, this time including this part of fluctuations. And the answer, the theoretical answer, was the correct one. The most probable solution, the most probable energy our branch will pick out of the landscape is the one at high energies. In fact, we discovered that because of this effect of the bath, of the fluctuations, we discovered that microscopically you can see each branch on the wave function settling at different vacuoles on the landscape. The ones that settle in very low vacuoles, they have all these fluctuations. You can think of them as particles, massive fluctuations. And we know what particles do, they like to crunch things. Energy blows things up. So all the branches that sat at low energy vacuole, they couldn't grow. They were terminal universes, because the crunch of this fluctuation, of their reaction, was stronger than that tiny energy they took to try and expand. But all the branches that said that very high energies, high energy vacuoles on the landscape, and that's not just ours, it's many other branches, all of them survived this back reaction of fluctuation and continue to grow and become classical universes. So we solved that equation, and we had to learn a lot of condensed matter, actually, to solve that n-body problem. It turns out that mathematically this kind of problem is similar to spin dots and quantum dots that condensed matter studied. But getting the right answer for the first time, theoretically, gave us hope that there must be a way to test this theory. Of course, we all knew that speed of light limit can travel beyond, can't take itself in the multiverse. We are fully aware of that. But there had to be a way to test this. And of course, the answer was very simple. Unitarity. We were doing quantum theory, quantum cosmology on this whole story. And we have a coherent continuous story. We can trace this branch from before the universe existed all the way to now, as it goes through quantum to classical transition, as it blows up, inflates, and then becomes a classical universe. So having that story, and the fact that everything, the whole calculation was based on quantum theory, meant that unitarity guaranteed that some traces of that infancy, of that entanglement from the early days were left in our sky today. And that's the beauty of cosmology, of course. It's a lab that preserves everything from its first moment and simply rescales it as the universe grows. So we calculated the effect of entanglement of our branch with everything else that survived in this quantum multiverse, quantum landscape. And we simply fast forwarded that effect from that first moment to now. It turns out that the net effect of that, of course, the net effect of entanglement is very, very big. But it turns out that it depends on scale, on wave number, so it's not uniform. And it provides a second source, independent of what you get from cosmic inflation. That's the fact, of course. While universe inflates and those ripples of the impact particles, the particle produce everything, the structure and the CMB. But on top of that dominant source, the entanglement source, introduces a modification to the background gravitational potential of the universe. It is a second source of fluctuations, if you like. So, since we calculated it, we knew how the gravitational potential of the universe now, besides the dominant effect from inflation, will have this additional source. From that point on, that's what goes into all the CMB and large scale structure predictions. So, from the moment we have calculated that correction to the gravitational potential, it was a matter of just putting it on CMB codes and finding out what the answer was. So that there, Tomo Takahashi in Japan joined us, and we made a series of predictions that I'll mention in a minute, which Tomo thought was completely crazy to talk about. And I thought it was okay to be crazy because they were going to be discovered when I'm still alive. So it turns out that they were not crazy, and many of them were actually observed when I'm still alive. There was a very nice illustration of this, of what I've described so far, in an Italian magazine, Focus magazine, that wrote about this work. So the background there will be the landscape, the potential energy. And what you have is branches of the wave function that have tried to go through this landscape. Once they settle, once they localize through a process known as Anderson localization, once they localize in each of these patches of the landscape, they take the energy they need to go through inflation and start growing into big universes. And then internally, you have all the structure and the CMB as it's typical in the story. That's before they start growing. So just about when these branches are still entangled, so they have localized on different various vacua of the landscape, they are taking the energy of that vacuum, but meanwhile, decoherence has not occurred yet. So as they are about to decohere, that quantum entanglement, that's what the shaded black area between those two surviving branches that are about to blow up. So that entanglement between those surviving universes leaves imprints on each other's sky. They modify each other's gravitational potential, therefore each other's CMB and large-scale structure. That effect from that very early moment, of course, can be fast-forwarded to present day because we know how our universe expanded, so that's easy to bring to present day. So what did we say? When you calculated the effect of entanglement. The first surprise was that there was an area in the sky of about 10 degrees, which is huge, that we call the giant void. This was in 2005. It was disturbing because 10 degrees in the sky is a big region of the sky. It spoils uniformity. That is a strong prediction of inflation. So we are nervous about it. So we predicted that the effect of this entanglement is to really diminish matter content on that particular region. It was observed initially about 8 months after the paper came out, and completely accidentally by a group of radio astronomers, Larry Rudnick et al. They were looking for something else, and they just pointed their telescopes on this direction. So there was a lot of back and forth between astronomers, whether that void was there or not. WMAP observed it, one of the CMB, major CMB experiments. Looking at temperature maps of the sky, of course, an area that doesn't have enough matter, it will get cold temperatures. So they called it a cold spot. But WMAP statistics were not, the data was not good enough to give good statistics and make this finding conclusive. And then Planck came along. They observed it and their data in 2013 and 2015 and now has improved those statistics tremendously. So the cold spot is that. That giant void in the southern hemisphere, at redshift about 1, of about 10 degrees in the sky, it is there for sure. Another effect that we found out, which again is easy to understand, we have major main contribution from inflation, plus this second contribution from entanglement in the gravitational potential. One of the things it does is to lower the overall amplitude of the CMB called sigma 8. So we calculated that it should be 0.8 instead of 1. So it's a lowering by 20%. That again has been confirmed by Planck. The suppressed temperature spectra at the lowest multiples. There are more models trying to explain that than there is data. It comes out as naturally in our model, in our theory, but again, there are so many models that try to come up with a way to suppress the spectra, but it has been observed and it's there. Another one was a power asymmetry. I mean, you expect all these effects to be at the largest possible scales. So besides the first giant void of about 10 degrees in the sky, we had a milder effect at the dipole level. So that would be in one hemisphere relative to the other. And that would show as a temperature asymmetry in temperature maps, but in our theory, that was a result of a power asymmetry of slightly less matter in the northern hemisphere than the southern hemisphere. You can think of a whole hemisphere, I mean, at the dipole level, that's like a giant void at that level. So that was another prediction. We predicted that supersymmetry breaking does not happen at Higgs energies. It will not, and that was before, of course, LHC tested for that. If supersymmetry breaks, then it will be at much higher energies, of about 100,000 times larger than the Higgs than PV energies. In our theory, the supersymmetry breaking scale is actually the energy you take from the local vacuum of the landscape. Each branch will settle in its own vacuum, which will have a different energy. So that's your local parameter. There is a global parameter, the string parameter or Newton's constant, Planck mass, but there's also a second unique label depending on where you set on that landscape vacuum. So if you include the fluctuations, and it's hard for me now without showing all the equations still, but if you follow forward the evolution of the universe plus those other fluctuations, then it turns out that a supersymmetry breaking at lower energies will be very problematic if you don't too much fluctuation into the CMB, which is ruled out already. There were some features at high multiples, but that's when shorter distances, that's when galaxy, gastrophysics takes over and any kind of wicked that come in and don't get washed out. So that's my favorite answer, because I've spent a decade working on it, and so far it's done well with observations. Of course, it quite rightly will not be the answer, but we're back into that problem of what gives the energy of inflation? How will the universe end? At least the anthropic and the fine-tuning arguments cannot be taken as seriously anymore, I think. But we are still staring at those two major problems as a matter of urgency. We have all the data to indicate what we don't understand about our universe. If I had to bet, I would say that the multiverse is the answer, because as I demonstrated, it is testable. We don't need to physically travel beyond the horizon of our universe in order to find ways of testing the existence of structures beyond our horizon. And all of those structures, whatever the theory, or whatever the model one comes up with, all of those can be tested simply because of unitarity. So there will always be imprints in our spine, in our universe, left from what happened before and what lies beyond. So I'm optimistic that these problems will be solved within a decade or so, and especially now when theory goes in tandem with precision cosmology. If that's the case, we have more problems to worry about. There are the deeper layers of nature. Time is one of those problems, but then the laws of nature and mathematics and the realms where they reside. Thank you.
As well as 5 minutes from the break. But urgent questions?
Could, at the moment of birth, the entropy of the universe not be zero? Just that.
That's a very, another unsolved problem and a very difficult problem. Yes, quantum mechanically, a pure state should have zero entropy. But that's only if you rely on quantum, and that's one of the problems with understanding the sitter states and the sitter entropy. I mean, on one hand, we say the sitter has got a certain entropy given by the horizon, but on the other, if it's a pure quantum state, it should have zero entropy. So, I don't know.
Yes, please. Yes, I heard you say that the universe was not very fine-tuned, but your own transparencies say the opposite, because it's the whole land is fine-tuned to 90 orders of magnitude, and alpha G over alpha is fine-tuned to 34 orders of magnitude according to flat atoms. These are huge tunings.
No.
Furthermore, within your parameter space, probably there are strong correlations between eta, Q, and whole lambda, so that you live in a kind of sub-manifold in there, which is not a fine-tuning.
To me, these numbers, I just picked one of the five plots I showed.
Yeah, well, nobody said that.
These numbers that's a wide parameter space.
Yes, but the space that you don't cover, the space that's excluded, is much less. So
there's an
enormous tuning, in other words, even with your argument.
I did not make a statement that all possible universes are included. My point was to show my point was to show that there is a wide space where these constants can take very different value from our universe and still be an inhabitable universe. Now, the explanation parsing, in fact, there is a quote in that original Weinberg paper on predicting dark energy. It says, well, this is the number I get, which is close to the empirical. But if there is a way to calculate it and find out that the amount of vacuum energy from anthropic arguments differs greatly from the empirical answer, then anthropics has lost all its explanation powers. And I have just showed in that bound on dark energy, that bound is less, rho lambda is less than 10 to the minus 90. That's 30 orders of magnitude, freedom.
Yeah, but it's 90 orders of magnitude less than 1. But furthermore,
there is always the bottle half full.
Tim Watt.
So let me just three very quick points, which you can do whatever you like. The first is that, of course, we know that although you presented inflation as part of standard cosmology, you said a lot of trouble. Steinhardt's given up on it. People are finally having to fine-tune the inflaton field in order to get. So it's not at all, at this point, generally accepted. But leave that aside. The two points I want to make, they're two conceptual points. One is you ask the question, where does the energy come from? But you have to ask a deeper question. What is energy? Why think that there's conservation of energy, and you have to ask where it comes from at all? We know that conservation of energy comes from Noether's principle. If you've got global killing fields, and we know when you do cosmology, you don't have global killing fields. So there's a very real question about whether calculations about energy even make sense in the context of doing cosmology. And the other point is just very quickly, this comment that the entropy has to be zero, that's the von Neumann entropy. That has nothing to do with thermodynamic entropy. It's this mechanical entropy that Penrose is calculating. So to say, oh, you start in a pure state, has zero entropy, that's the wrong entropy.
Why should the thermodynamic one be better than the von Neumann?
Because you can have a pure state of any thermodynamic entropy you like. They just have no relation to each other at all. Especially if you're doing cosmology. If you start in a pure state, you're going to stay in a pure state forever. But that doesn't mean the thermodynamic entropy doesn't go up, of course it does.
Answers?
Okay.
First one, I am not aware. Thank you. I am not aware of replacement for cosmic inflation just yet. Second one, talking about global killing fields and vectors. We are already making an assumption of general relativity in a real space-time. I moved on to a landscape of string theory, which is an abstract space and into quantum cosmology. And the third one, entropy is such a kind of worms that we can talk after in the coffee break about thermodynamic on human bolts and entropy or whatnot, but that is a major problem, especially for the superspace, the issue of the entropy. Especially in the thermodynamics and third time freezes, because entropy can't change.
Okay, we're going to have three more questions. You, and you.
I enjoyed the talk, which I found not so controversial, apart from two things. First of all, the multiple vacua of string theory did not come as a shock in 2003. We've known about it since the 1980s. The second thing is, if you talk about varying Newton's constant being your alpha, your dimensionless alpha, that's a sensible question. But when you talk about G over G naught, that's a property of your units, not a property of nature. G over G naught can be one forever and ever if I choose my favorite units.
Did you read that book, The Death of String Theory, in 2004? Never mind. The second question. So, G is a constant of nature, alpha is a constant of nature. What I showed there is contour plots where both G and alpha are allowed to vary.
Yes, but alpha is a dimensionless number, which is the same in any unit.
And I made the...
depends on one choice of units.
I said, which is why I moved into that alpha G, I made the G dimensionless as well.
Yes, but G over G naught depends on your units. Alpha does not.
Yeah.
Next question. Go ahead.
You sent another one. This last one, sorry.
Yes,
I should have written an alpha G there. Sorry.
You sent a lot on fundamental questions and what. You stated that it's often a question to ask the right questions. And actually, it is often a question of how to look at things. So many of the statements you made are actually very frame dependent, what fields you choose. For example, physical time, even in standard inflation of the universes, can go to past infinity. There needs not to be a beginning. You see that easily if you go to a different frame, your particle masses change. And if you really count physical time, let's say oscillation, something that is frame independent, everything oscillates an independent number of times. So that's one of these examples. So there needs not to be a beginning. The second is the beginning stage of inflation a natural state or not? I think, you know, it's a state with just a couple of fields and a few fluctuations. Couldn't be simpler. I do not see why you say this is a specially fine-tuned state. So there's only two of them. There are a few more, but a little remark, nevertheless, for side remark. Dynamical dark energy, so if dark energy is connected to a particle or to a field, does not lead in general to a big crunch. I think I know that I've proposed these theories, and these are much more harmless
theories. So particle or field doesn't.
Yeah, if you have just a scalar field for dynamical dark energy, I call it a Boltzmann particle, this will not lead to a big crunch. It's much more harmless. There is no reason. I mean, it can either settle to a vacuum, then it looks like a cosmological constant. Most likely it goes forever, then you have some scaling solution in the future, but usually it will not go to a big crunch.
Okay, so the dark energy application. The dark energy, I mentioned that the data this year is weirder. I mean, there are so many models that I can't talk about them one by one. There's a big leap, a big crunch, and a big freeze. Those are the most popular sensational models. There is quintessence model and many others. It's probably 1 or 2,000 models, so I didn't want to go to case by case. You never go to a big crunch?
I'm not saying never, but you can do a lot of complicated things. The normal scale of field will not go to a big crunch.
Big rip is even worse, you need to do a lot.
Big rip is worse because that's not a well defined theory.
But
fine.
Models apart, because it would be impossible to discuss all of them. Models apart, the data this year is this. It's getting very interesting, and it will turn out probably that none of the papers written so far on dark energy are correct. And we have this conflict between the supernovae team, again, the measurement of the Hubble constant, and the Planck results on the Hubble constant, and there is a huge disagreement there, and it boils down to what dark energy is. Now, fighting over Planck's constant, I remember that in the very first conference I went when I was a graduate student. So it's a theme that occurs every year. But I think this kind of fight is different. And the latest arguments are that dark energy can be so much more different from what we think it is, that it might even make our universe to be 12 million years old instead of 13.8 billion years old. I enjoy this kind of problems, I love it, but I'm sure astronomers wait, I don't answer the second one. The second one, inflation. Thank you for making that point because I lost over a lot of things. Inflation does require a tremendous amount of fine-tuning, so in some sense he was right to complain about inflation. Besides the high energy required, you also need that high energy to fall into an exquisitely smooth patch of space-time. If it doesn't, you don't get inflation. That thing will not blow up. So that's what my hand writes. It's one of those hidden assumptions. That not only do you have this inflaton particle with a lot of energy, but that has to go and find exactly that very exquisitely tuned patch of space that it inflates. And that's the original problem of fine-tuning of inflation, but if you translate that second requirement, which is what Malcolm and I did a few years ago, and then I believe Thomas Hertog and Stephen Hawking followed 3 years later, if you use that second requirement, the smoothness of the background, into the existence of inflation, it turns out that eternal inflation switches over very quickly. It's not eternal.
It's again a very frame-dependent statement. I can just assure you, if you look at it in a different frame of how the masses change, where the universe, let's say, exists forever, it's very simple to fulfill these requirements for inflation. It's the standard thing that will come out. So I'm just making the point when you say you should be careful what type of questions you ask. You have to figure out which properties are related to a special choice of frame and which are really physical. Because some high energy is not a frame-independent quantity. And I think it is important to concentrate on the physical quantities. Yourself, you look a lot at problems where constants change, massical change, and so on. So you better go to a setting where you are not concentrating on particular features of the Einstein frame which keeps these masses fixed. And in a more general view, you see many of these so-called paradoxes, they just go away. You have to be careful when you say things need to be tuned. Very often they do not need to be tuned.
I agree with half of what you said. First, to choose the properties, I have to ask the question, otherwise what properties would I be choosing? And secondly, nature doesn't care which term we choose. So certain problems are real problems of nature.
So you better take it in a frame, in a kind of way.
No, without the
frame. Final question.
Yes. Well, my question is, taking into account that it was a primordial entanglement inside our own universe, and I'm not thinking now of other universes, because we know from quantum mechanics that everything that gets in close contact gets involved. So the primordial entanglement inside our own universe couldn't be capable to explain the problems that, or solve the problem that normally we assume, or many people assume, to be solved by inflation. In other words, it couldn't be that primordial entanglement could be an alternative to inflation. Because for the problem of horizon, for example, is very clear. The problem of horizon is completely solved by quantum entanglement.
It is too weak. So it's a second weak source, but again, I'm getting this feeling of inflation not being the right one and the need to replace it. In what I talked about, I did take cosmic inflation to be our standard model of cosmology. Are there alternatives? I'm sure. But that's not what I consider here. Entanglement itself, this primordial entanglement, is way, way too weak. It's been rescaled by the size of the universe. No, it would never. It doesn't mean one cannot come up with some models to make it happen. But judging from the past efforts, there have been efforts to try and replace inflation with something better, and the recurring theme is that those other models require even more tuning and more contriving and tweaking than inflation. So that there is a reason. I haven't put the boundary in there. I have no reason to defend inflation, but there is a very good reason why we stand by it. It's got problems, but it doesn't mean that the whole theory is wrong. In fact, I would say it's an incomplete theory. And that's often the case in physics. It's almost the case in every discovery that this theory, think of Einstein's theory, didn't mean Newton's theory is wrong. Einstein transcended Newton's theory, he didn't replace Newton's theory. Newton's theory is still correct. And I believe something similar to happen in the future with inflation. That's just part of the story, but we need to embed it into something better.
Okay, people, time remains a mystery. Timekeeping remains difficult. We'll meet again in 15 minutes.